All right, BCA-101, Monday, 4/24/17, day 39. We talked about basic design, we talked about top-down, then we talked about bottom-up. We talked about programming, source code, and then students had actually a fair amount of time to work on the project, Project 5 databases. So, top-down design, complex problems, problems where you can't afford to have the information system not work, and we've talked about a number of examples. So, we reviewed a little bit, defined the problem, and then analyzed the problem, and then we get feedback, okay? Say, okay, this is what we think we have, and this is the flow of information. How's that sound? And you keep doing this loop until you're sure you understand. We'll talk a little more about return on investment. Once you've done the analysis, the next thing you do is you start designing. And the same thing is true here. You create this feedback loop. Design what you think the information system is going to look like and how it would work. You get all kinds of feedback, and then you redesign and get feedback and so forth. And then a crucial point, when you go from design to development and you actually start creating the information system. Now you could always stop, but boy, you know, you're getting to where you're quite a ways into the process to back out. Then we'll talk about implementation, putting it into effect, and then we evaluate and we do maintenance. Let's look at it a little again. Define the problem. Top-down design is very good for complex information systems. Air traffic controllers, things you can't afford not to have it work. So when people look at an information system, they look for a return on investment. Some do a cost-benefit analysis, you know, we're guessing these are going to be the cost and these are going to be the benefits. The benefits sometimes aren't always money. They might bring, really important, they might bring value to your company or what you're doing. Okay? So, we call it return on investment, but it doesn't necessarily have to be money. Okay. So, we already talked about feedback, design, then development. By hardware and software. Software, now you can buy it or you can make it, and there's typically some wiggle room in between there. Which is more expensive? Making it. Way more expensive. But why make it if you can buy some? Well, maybe you can't buy exactly what you want. Or maybe you're trying to build a competitive edge, like Walmart. Walmart always seems to manage their supply chain really well because of their information system. Now we're going to put it into place. You could phase it in, put in one part, and then one part, and then another part, and then another part. Or you can run a pilot, run it in one store. That works pretty well, then another store and maybe a couple others. Or in some cases, you don't have a choice but to cut over. Completely quit the way you were doing and do it the new way. This might have the least amount of cost, but it might be the most dangerous, because if it doesn't work, you don't have the old way to fall back on. Find something wrong. You investigate the problem, and you can go through the steps again. Now, another way to approach this is to do it bottom up. another way to think of it. You actually look at doing these together. You do a quick analysis, design something, and then develop it and create a prototype. And then here, you just keep updating the prototype. Way faster than top-down. A little more dangerous, because if your prototype's way off, you might have to completely start over. But it's the way a lot of people do things. A good example would be PowerPoints or any kind of presentation. You kind of just make the slides on the go. And then you can always rearrange them and so forth. You don't storyboard it all out, usually, and then create them. Spreadsheets, a lot of times people create spreadsheets that way too. Alright. So, if we're going to make it, we're going to make the software to create a competitive advantage, or there's nothing out there to buy, you're going to need to program. Define and understand the problem, the purpose. What do you want to accomplish? Get the specifications, what things we need to meet. You can design it. Pseudocode is false code, looks like text, flowcharts, we'll take a look at those later. Those would be diagrams that show where the flow goes in terms of program. Code, actual code that we write, and then we test it, and you document the process. We'll look at a few more examples, but when people code, they write source code, typically in what we would call high-level language. Okay. These are things that you might have heard of, like C++, Python, Perl, Java, Fortran, Pascal, COBOL, some older languages. So we have high-level languages that allow humans to write code, instructions for the computer. Then we take either a compiler or an interpreter to convert it into object code. This is more low-level. A generic term, but this is something the computer will understand. Not so much as a human, but a computer understand. Then you add in other code, which really makes sense, pre-written things, and you what they call link it into an executable code. This is something the computer can execute. The compiler will compile the executable code based on the operating system. So if it compiles for Windows, then it needs to run on Windows. If it compiles it for a Macintosh, then it needs to run on a Macintosh. Okay? And that's it for today.